say, go ahead and look at somebody right now and say, God showed up last night. Yes, he did. It was amazing. I want you to know, man, that is a sermon that I do not do very often. That is something that is so very serious and so very sacred, and only when God calls me to preach it. But I believe with all of my heart that God called me to preach last night to you on the death of our Savior and our Lord, Jesus Christ, and what he did for us. Amen? Amen, amen, amen. Look at somebody else on the other side of you right now. Go ahead and look them square in the eyes right now. Look at them and just say, God's not done. God's got more to go. So you better listen up. I don't know about you. I don't know about you. But first of all, I love to have fun. How many of y'all love to have fun? Raise your hand. You love to have a good time. I'm a little bit crazy, right? I'm a little bit wacko. Like, I really love not just to have fun, but I love to kind of live my life on the line. I like to live a little dangerously. You know what I'm saying? I love a little exhilaration. I love a little adventure in my life. I hate to be bored. Anybody hate to be bored up here, man? I can't stand to be bored. I remember there was a time when I was 18 years old. I was on my senior trip down to Miami, Florida, and we were hanging out all the seniors together, and we went to like this big go-kart park, and they had there the tallest in the world at the time, the tallest one of those huge pendulum swings. And I remember thinking to myself, I have got to get up on that pendulum swing, and I've got to experience this adventure, this danger, this exhilaration. I love my life being on the line, right? So I remember I got two of my friends, it was all three of us, and they harnessed us up there on the ground. We had this one-inch cable that was holding us, and then that swing started taking us all the way to the top, some 300 feet in the air. I mean, we were a football field high. We were dangling there by this cable that was about an inch in diameter, and we were hanging down, and we were looking at the ground, and I remember someone on the ground screaming to us, 300 feet in the air, pull the cord! Pull the cord! Well, at that point, we were kind of questioning, what were we doing up there anyways? This is crazy. We are hanging face down, looking at concrete below us, and we were going to swing down just to about above 5 feet above the ground, going face first into this concrete, and my friends, the cord was on my side, my friends were begging me, don't pull the cord! Whatever you do, Chip, don't pull the cord! And so everybody was watching us, our whole senior class, and they started counting, 3, 2, 1, and I pulled the cord, and it was one of those moments where we were screaming, but nothing was coming out of our mouth. We had no air, we had no oxygen, we were nose diving to the ground 300 feet below us, concrete, and as we were falling down, right before we hit the ground, the swing catches us, and we swing back out of the air, and we just can't help but scream and laugh because we were living this exhilaration, this danger, life on the line, this adventure. And I want you to know, that's what it feels like, but even better, to live your life for Jesus. See, Satan wants you to live a boring life. Satan wants you to live careful. Satan wants you to live comfortable. Satan wants you to live for yourself, where you think that life is just all about me. But when we talk about last night, that Jesus didn't just lay his life on the line, he laid his life down for us. Jesus took on death for us. Why? Not so that we could experience a boring, lethargic, pathetic life, but so that he could fill us up with the Spirit, so that we could take our love for fun and exhilaration and adventure and live it for him. See, here's the deal. You will not enjoy your life to the fullest unless you're living for Jesus to the fullest. Amen? That's what God has for us. And we need teenagers to rise up and to understand that. Put your hands together and give it up for Jesus right now. He wants to give your life. He wants to give you life. But listen, you will not get the life until you are willing to go through death. You will not get that life until you're willing to go through death. I told you last night that we will not be willing to live our life for Jesus unless we're willing to die for Jesus. And we will not be willing to die for Jesus unless we understand Jesus' death for us. Isn't it amazing? Isn't it incredible? Isn't it inspiring? Isn't it awesome that Jesus doesn't ask us to do anything for him that he hasn't already done for us first? He gave his life for us. He died for us. And I want us to be very careful. I want us to be very careful in understanding and remembering that when we talk about death, the world views death, listen to me, as the end of life. But God views death as the beginning of life. That's when we start to live. I'm talking about dying to yourself. I'm talking about dying to sin. I'm talking about dying to boringness. I'm talking about dying to Satan. I'm talking about dying to pride. I'm saying that when we lose our lives, that is when we find it in Jesus Christ. And so you need to think right now and you need to pray right now. God, help me not to live like everybody else. Help me not to be like everybody else. God, I want to experience this life in Jesus because the world, I don't know if you've noticed, is depressed. The world is stressed. The world is suicidal. The world is lost. The world is confused. The world is in doubt. But God brings clarity, and God brings power, and God brings truth, and God brings confidence because God shows us who he is and who he has created us to be. So here's what I want to do this morning very quickly. I've got five things that I want to show you that God has taught me when he's calling us to live our life for him, to die to ourselves and to live for him. You know, other religions say, if you want your God to love you, you must suffer for him. And that is not the way our God rolls. That is not what Jesus said. Jesus didn't say, I will love you when you suffer for me. Jesus said, I love you, so I suffered for you. God isn't calling us saying, go and suffer for me so that you can make me proud. God is saying, I want you to go and live for me. And that will mean that you will be willing to go through suffering. See, it's not saying I'm going to go looking for suffering. It's saying that I'm going to be willing to go through suffering. And those are two very completely different things. And so I want to share with you real quick from Acts chapter 20 this morning, what God was doing in the Apostle Paul's life as he was calling him to live on mission. Because I'll be honest with you, as you can tell, this conference is very different. Normally what student pastors and speakers and worship bands are calling students to do is just saying, look, we just want you to live a good life, and we just want you to believe in Jesus, and we just want you to have faith in him. But that's not all that Jesus said. Jesus said, not only do I want you to believe in me, Jesus said, I want you to be living for me. Because when we are truly believing in Jesus, that is when we will truly be living for Jesus. We need this generation, you, to leave here this weekend and to say, I am forever changed in Jesus Christ, and I will be living with him, and I will be living for him, and I don't care what the world says, I care what the Word says. Because the world can't give me what God promised me. Very quickly, Acts chapter 20, verse 18 says this. Acts chapter 20, verse 18 says, Paul said, you yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia. Number one, missional living is real life. Missional living is real life. Now, when I say missional living, what do I mean? Missional living is when we live our life in such of a way every single day that someone could get saved. Missional living is when we live our life in such a way every single day that someone could get saved. Paul says when he would go into a city, he wasn't just going to preach. He wasn't just going to teach and then to roll out. Paul said, I came and I loved you and I lived among you. Here's what that teaches me. If we want to be different, if I want to live a life of adventure and exhilaration with Jesus that he's offering me, first of all, I've got to live my life with him. So every day, Jesus has challenged me. Jesus has encouraged me. He's empowered me to wake up an hour earlier than what I need to just to spend time with Jesus because I need to be filled with him. Because I need to be filled with the Spirit. I'll read the one-year Bible, so I'll read the Old Testament, the New Testament, and the Psalms, and the Proverbs every single day because I need to think like Jesus and less like Chip. I need Jesus so much in my life that I need to spend my morning with him so that I can live my day with him. I need my relationship with Jesus. He's the one that empowers me to live that life of exhilaration. But also we need each other. Paul said, I went in and noticed how I lived among you the whole time. I need you, and you need me, and you need one another around you. And there was no better time in my life that God showed me this than when I took a mission trip to the Amazon jungle in Brazil this past October. You talk about a life-changing trip. I mean, I had people telling me not to go. I had people telling me it was too dangerous. I had people telling me that I could die, that I could be killed. I had people telling me that I could never come back. But all I can tell you is that God called me to go, and I don't want to just live a life of danger, exhilaration, and adventure by doing dumb things like bungee jumping. I want to use that for Jesus. And so I wanted to go to the place in the world that has the least contacted people in the entire world. The largest concentration of uncontacted people in the world is the Amazon jungle. And so God gave me this opportunity to go. And not only to go, but to go into the very last town. That after this town, all there is jungle. All there is nothingness. All there is that wilderness. All there is that uncontacted area. All there is the wild. And this last town that I got to go to before the jungle is this forgotten town that's known as the end of the world. These discarded, left out, isolated people. I got to be a part of the first mission team, short-term mission team of the Southern Baptist to ever go into this town. And I'll be honest with you, when we get in this town, we were warned. Be very careful what you say. Be very careful what you do. Be very careful even the way that you look at people. Because very easily, riots raise up in this town and they have killed many missionaries in the past. And I remember going into this town, and the first night going into this missionary's home, and it was dark outside. And we could hear all the wild animals around this house. And we knew all the people that understood who we were, but yet they hated what we were about. And we met in this house, and there was about 10 of us that circled around with missionaries and pastors and other believers and Christians. And we just circled around, and we realized where we were. And we realized the danger around us. And so what we began to do is just begin to speak scripture into one another's lives and share testimonies with one another. And we began to sing about Jesus together. And we began to pray for one another that not only God would protect us, but that God would empower us for the mission that he had called us to. And that just, it hit me. That is what we need to do every single day together in America. See, we may not have all of these physical dangers in America, but we have all of these spiritual dangers to where Satan has this power over us to distract us from Jesus and to elevate things above Jesus, that we would have a love for the world more than this love for Jesus, which is called sin. And we live in this danger every single day. And we need one another to encourage each other, to pray together. That's why we believe in groups. That's why we believe in accountability. That's why we believe in community. That's why we believe in times of getting together as a church. That's why we believe in worship. That's why we believe in encouragement, that we are called to live together every single day for encouragement and empowerment. And then the Apostle Paul said this in verse 19. He says, "And I was serving the Lord Jesus with all humility and with tears and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews." Please hear me. Missional living and living your life for Jesus requires great, as you saw in the verse, humility. Humility is not just thinking terrible thoughts of yourself or putting yourself down. It is putting Jesus first. It's saying, "Jesus, you come before me. Jesus, you're more important than me. Jesus, I live for your glory." It's not about my name, but Jesus, about your name. It's living a humble life, and that will even, listen to me, that will even bring tears, because it brings suffering. We don't need to go looking for suffering. Suffering will come looking for us. All of suffering is designed by Satan. But here's God's promise. God is not just delighted when we suffer. God comes to our rescue when we suffer. And he often doesn't even do away with our suffering. Instead, what he does is he empowers us in a way that we can endure the suffering that we're going through for his name. So God calls us to this life of humility, and he calls us to even a life at times of tears, in pain, in torment. But he remembers, we remember that Jesus went before us, and Jesus did this for us first. I met a young man in Brazil in his 20s, early 20s. And he said, "You know," he said, "I'm so glad you came to my town, a town of thousands. There were only about 10 or less Christians there." And he looked at us and he said, "God has called me to go to my people and to be a pastor. But," he said, "I know the last pastor that tried to reach these people, they poisoned him and they killed him. But," he said, "I would rather live my life on the line for Jesus than to live a comfortable, careful life, or a life that doesn't take any chances, a life that doesn't experience any adventure. Man, I want to live my life for Jesus than I would rather live my life without Jesus." He says, "I want to give my life for Jesus because Jesus gave his life for me, and that's the kind of life I want to live." So number one, missional living is real life. Number two, missional living, if you're writing this down, is humbly serving. It is humbly serving Jesus. It is putting Jesus first and seeing Jesus as our King. Number three, very quickly, verse 20 and 21 says this. The Apostle Paul says, "Notice how I did not shrink back from declaring to you anything that was profitable in teaching you in public and from house to house, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of repentance towards God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ." Number three, missional living is speaking up. If you ever heard that quote, that statement before that says, "Share the gospel and use words if necessary," that's a lie. The gospel always requires words. The gospel always requires us to tell. The gospel always requires us to speak the name of Jesus. Your friends, your family, your city, your people, they need to hear the name of Jesus. Paul said, "I don't want to shrink back. I don't want to be a coward. I don't want to live my life in fear. I don't want to live scared. I want to live bold. I want to live courageous. I want to live my life by the power of the Holy Spirit." Paul says, "I'm not going to shrink back, but I'm going to speak up. I'm going to share them the name that is above every name." Amen. While I was in Brazil, in that same house, sat a young man. I had no idea who he was or what he was doing there. He couldn't even speak English. He had an interpreter there. One of the missionaries was interpreting for him. And this young man started to share his story. that he grew up in a tribe in the Amazon jungle. And God did a miracle. And very few of people from the tribes of the Amazon jungle have an opportunity to even hear the gospel because it's illegal to take the gospel to them. And this young man shared how God did a miracle and God saved him and he believed in Jesus. And listen to me. For the past several years, he has spent his life memorizing the Bible. He had memorized 126 stories of the scriptures, word for word, from the Bible, because the Bible is illegal in the Amazon jungle, so that he could go, and maybe he could not hold the book, but he held the book in his heart, and he could share the Bible word for word, sharing stories to his people. In the same way, teenagers, you need to know the Word of God. You need to know the stories and the truths of Scripture. You need to know the words and the sayings of Jesus. You need to know the Old Testament and the New Testament. You need to know the gospel so that you can go and share. I remember sitting with my brother-in-law one night who is unsaved, and he refuses to give his life for Jesus. And I remember sitting with him one night at my kitchen table, and he said, "Chip, you can tell me anything you want to tell me about your faith, but you cannot open that Bible. Do not open that book, but you can tell me whatever you want to say." And the Holy Spirit started working in my mind and working in my heart, recalling all of the scriptures and stories and doctrines and truths and gospel that I had memorized, that the Holy Spirit had taught me, to where I was able to not just be lost, but be able to communicate what God wanted him to know, and not just dependent upon the pages, but upon the word that was written on my heart. Are you prepared to do the same? Do you know the scriptures? Is the gospel of first importance to you? Is Jesus your King? Is he your Lord? Does he come first? Do you spend time with him? Do you memorize his word so that you can live his word and you can teach his word to others? In verse 22, Paul says, "And now behold, I'm going to Jerusalem." He said, "I'm constrained by the Holy Spirit. I do not know what's going to happen to me there, except the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me." Listen, I know when you go home, when you get around your friends, when you go to your school, when you're hanging out in your neighborhood, I understand if you get radical for Jesus, there will be people who turn on you. There will be people who make fun of you. There will be people who isolate you, who defriend you. There will be people who don't want to hang out with you or talk about you. I understand that. And so what our tendency is, because of our sin, is to shrink back and to cower back. We know that afflictions, we know that trials await us if we really live our life for Jesus. But let me ask you a question. What if you don't live your life for Jesus? What if you do shut up? What if you do cower back? What if you don't open your mouth? Then what's going to happen to them? Then how is your family going to hear? Then how are your friends going to know? Then how is God going to use you? See, God is calling us to live adventurous lives where we are willing to suffer, where we're willing to speak, where we're willing to act, where we're willing to be different, because only when you're willing is when God will show up and God will use you and God will empower you and he will do miracles through you. I believe in that God. I believe in the God who's called you and he has promised to say that I will use you. So number four, missional living is living Spirit-led. A missionary told us a story while we were there, and he said, "Chip, I got to go 100 miles into the Amazon jungle." He said, 100 miles in the Amazon jungle, when we were trying to reach a certain people for Jesus, we were trying to find them because they're nomadic. They're traveling around all over the place. He said, "At night, we would string up our hammocks around the campfire about 4 feet off the ground because of all of the jaguar that would walk into our camp." And he said the deal about Jaguar is that they have to see you, hear you, and smell you before they attack you. So he said they laid mosquito nets over their hammocks and they would sleep there all night. And he said that as he was sleeping, he would wake up to the hot breathing, the loud breathing of the jaguar that were roaming around at night, that were walking under his hammock. He said he was scared out of his mind. He said this was my first night in the jungle. He said that he cried all night long. But here's what he told me. He looked in my eye and he said, "But Chip, I wasn't just crying because I was scared to death." He said, "I was crying because I always thought I was scared to share Jesus with my neighbors." He said, "I always thought I was scared to share Jesus with my friends." He said, "I didn't know what fear was. Now I know what fear is. My life is on the line." He said, "Back in America, my life wasn't on the line. I was just believing the lie that I was in danger." He said, "Man, I wish I had that kind of freedom again. Because now I'm traveling illegally, risking my very life to be able to tell people about Jesus. And this is what he's called me to do." And he said, "I love what I get to do." He said, "I wish I could just take my past back. And I wish I would be able to do everything that I could have done to tell everyone that I could have told about Jesus." And that's what the Spirit of God does in us. When we spend time with Jesus in his word, he fills us with his Spirit so that we get to communicate it to others. And then lastly, very quickly, verse 24, this is my life verse, not because I live it, but because I strive. This is my desire. This is the passion of my heart. This is the way that I want to live. But I do not account my life of any value, nor is precious to myself, if only I may finish my course in the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. Missional living is lifelong. It's for the rest of our lives. It is an everyday pursuit. I want to live different every day in such a way that someone could get saved. I don't want to value my life. I don't want to see me as precious. I want to value the gospel and see our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I want to finish the course that I've received, the life, the ministry from the Lord Jesus, to testify to the gospel of the grace of God." Amen. Same missionary, he told me that he was following this pastor into the jungle, 100 miles to go and reach these people. He said it was his first days even in the Amazon. He didn't know where he was going. He didn't know what to expect. He didn't know what was happening. Here's what he told me. He said, "Chip, when we're about 100 miles into the jungle deep," he said, "a poisonous snake bit the pastor, my guide, a deadly snake, and he fell out and he was dying on the jungle floor." He said, "I had no idea what to do. I would have never made it out." He said, "I was lost." He said, "All I knew to do was just start praying." He said, "We had been looking for these people. We had been searching for them to share the gospel." He was thinking to himself, "God, how could you allow this to happen? The pastor that I've been following, my guide, the one who's going to lead me to these people, and now he's dying on the jungle floor, bitten by a poisonous, deadly snake, and now he's going to die, and now this whole mission is lost." He said, "All I knew to do was to fall on top of the pastor and start praying." So he said, "I fell on the pastor who was dying on the jungle floor." He said, "I started praying and screaming Jesus' name as loud as I could." He said, "I don't know how long I was praying for, but after several minutes, the pastor sat up and he looked at me in the face and he was healed." And the pastor said, "Amen, amen." And the pastor said, "God told me it's time to go." And he said, "I'm with you, bro." They trekked their way back out of the jungle. He said a few days passed by, and the people, the tribe that they were looking for, A few of the elders came out of the jungle, came up to the city that they had come back to, looking for those men. The people of the city led them to the missionary and the pastor, and the people said, "We were watching you walk through the jungle. We watched the snake bite you. We watched you pray and call on your God. We heard you, and we saw God heal you. Would you tell us about your God? Would you tell us about your Savior? Would you tell us about your Lord? Would you tell us about your healer? Would you tell us about your God?" And here's what I need you to hear me say. People are watching you. People are watching you. In the way in which we live our life, we are saying something about Jesus. The way in which we talk, we're saying something about Jesus. See, when God puts his Spirit in you, you can't help but be a witness. The question is, who or what are you witnessing for? They know who you are. They know what you live for. The question is will we tell them? Will we live this boring, pathetic, lazy life that Satan makes us comfortable and careful? Or will we say, "Jesus, you died for me. Jesus, you gave your life for me. Jesus, you suffered for my sin. You forgave me. And so, Jesus, because you suffered for me, I am willing to go through suffering for you so that you can be known, so that they can be forgiven, so that they can believe, so that you can be glorified, so that you can be worshiped." God has exhilaration and adventure and danger for you. Do not live a life that is not worthy of suffering for him. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Heavenly Father, I pray right here, right now, in the name of Jesus, that you would fill us with your Spirit. God, we don't have the strength to suffer. We don't have the strength to stand. We don't have the strength to speak up. We don't have the strength to go forward. God, we are empty, broken, contaminated vessels because of our sin. But God, when you fill us with your Spirit, when you make us like your Son, God, I pray, Father, that we would live this life of exhilaration and adventure, and God, that we would enjoy this life of suffering, that we would enjoy the glory we get to bring to Jesus, that we would enjoy the cross that is set before us, that we would enjoy what it feels like to experience you and to live for you and to tell others about you, because that is what true joy is. God, we love you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Put your hands together for Jesus, the one who suffered and died for you. Awesome, awesome.